of every Catholic Church throughout the whole world. An image of Christ crucified is always prominently displayed. As Catholic Christians, we also make the sign of the cross at the beginning and ending of every Mass, and repeatedly throughout the liturgy. It is also our Catholic custom to make the sign of the cross before and after nearly all the prayers, we might say, before meals, before going to bed, at prayers at the beginning and ending of the rosary. But I wonder, are we often on automatic pilot, seldom thinking about what we are doing? The cross is before us every day, but do we really see its power and majesty? And why, in the tradition of the Catholic Church, should this image of torture and shame be enthroned with such reverence and honor? Why should we hear today's appointed gospel describing an incident at the Lord's Passion on this exultant solemnity of Christ the King? After all, at the time of Jesus, in the days of the ancient Roman Empire, even the word cross was considered to be an obscenity. That word, even pagan Romans were accustomed to being entertained at gladiator shows. The word itself was considered odious. It's not at all difficult to understand why. To die on the cross was the most shameful, the most repellent of all possible deaths. In a trial, a Roman citizen who was found guilty of a crime could be put to death, but not by crucifixion. Only slaves, only foreign criminals or enemy rebels could be sentenced to death in that particular horrific manner. Crucifixion was really an example of state terrorism. This is what the power of Rome can do to anyone who dares to challenge our empire. Remember, when someone was crucified, they were first mercilessly flogged with a ferocity that literally tore the flesh off their body. Then the condemned were forced to carry their cross, most often just the cross beam, to a place of public execution. They were stripped and then nailed, probably through their wrists, to the crossbeam. Next, in what must have been an excruciating process, the beam was pulled up on a standing pole, upon which their feet were spiked. Their entire weight, now hanging by their arms, with their legs deliberately bent, required the condemned to painfully raise themselves up for every breath they took. Most victims, after what could be hours, even days of unimaginable agony, usually finally died from asphyxiation or sheer exhaustion. Is it any wonder that decent people would avert their eyes and look away passing by a place of execution, usually located just outside the city gates? Only sadists, or the very worst elements of the mob, would ever want to watch something as humiliating, a spectacle of death enacted in this truly horrendous form of torture. So why in the world do Catholics intentionally honor the cross of Christ? Why do they so treasure the spoken words of today's gospel on an important holy day when we joyfully acclaim Christ as our King, as our Lord, as our Master of the universe? The answer is good news. Jesus loved us so much that he passed through death, even death on the cross, so that we could live forever. So extravagant is God's love. So amazing is God's grace. So boundless is God's mercy that the Father gave his Son as a ransom for sinners. In the face of this world's endless cruelty, Jesus, who could have summoned 12 legions of angels to wage war in his defense, instead, out of love for us, emptied himself, taking on the form of a slave, humbled himself, obedient, even death on a cross. Jesus stood where we belong. Jesus received the punishment that we deserve. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that those who believe in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Salvation through faith in Jesus is rather dramatically witnessed for us in the example of the good thief. In the four Gospels, he's only mentioned in the Gospel of Luke. He was perhaps a revolutionary. Our tradition gives him a name, Dismas, a Greek name meaning sunset. Jesus was nailed to a cross with two criminals. One of the condemned, most likely in despair, joins with the priests and elders in ridiculing Jesus. If you are Christ, save us and yourself. But the other condemned man rebukes him. We are being punished justly, for the sentence we receive corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then, perhaps pulling off the greatest single act of thievery in the entire history of the human race, the good thief actually steals heaven. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And the Lord replies, this day you will be with me in paradise. So the royal road to the cross is the glory of the church and the only way to our salvation. Through the holy cross we receive strength from weakness, splendor from shame, life from death. Jesus taught that all those who wish to follow him should deny themselves and take up their cross and follow in his footsteps. Yet how often do we reflect upon that invitation when we so automatically and often thoughtlessly sign ourselves with the sign of the cross? At baptism, we have been crucified with Christ and died with him, and so our death should no longer teach us we own ourselves, but instead God owns us, because we are one with the risen blood Christ living within us. For believers, the sign of the cross should be branded on our hearts and sealed into our souls. But when we betray the Holy Cross, when we love our sins more than we love Jesus, whenever we ignore the needs of others, when we hold back from service in the church, if we want to follow Jesus, we must first empty ourselves, become servants of one another, and boast of nothing but the cross of Christ. Every time we celebrate the Mass, that one perfect sacrifice of Christ crucified, that sacrifice is renewed in our midst with all its infinite power and endless. In the Eucharist, we stand before the glorious cross of Christ. What had once been a repulsive obscenity is now for us the sacred place of worship and the awesome altar of sacrifice. Jesus himself declared to his disciples, "This is my body given up for you. This is my blood poured out for you." Jesus is the acceptable sacrifice that makes atonement for the sins of the world. Jesus is our high priest, pleading to the Father on our behalf. Jesus is our King. Jesus is our Master. Jesus is the Savior of the world. For by the blood of Christ shed upon the cross, Satan was conquered, death defeated, the gates of hell have been smashed, sinners delivered, and the gates of heaven open wide for all those who, like Dismas, look upon the Lord and believe. The holy sacrifice of the Mass we share together, that boundless bounty of the cross. So in our daily lives, we must strive to live the holy mysteries we celebrate. There is a much revered Christian prayer of thanksgiving that believers are invited to pray after receiving Holy Communion. It celebrates the essential unity of the cross and the Mass, and renews our commitment to passionately live our Christianity. It goes, "Good and gentle Jesus, I kneel before you. I see and ponder your five holy wounds. My eyes behold what David prophesied about you. They have pierced my hands and feet. They have counted all my bones." May we engrave that image of the cross in our hearts, and may God give us the faith, hope, and love that is repentance for our sins and a commitment to new life. Dear brothers and sisters, as we conclude this year of grace 2019 and celebrate this great solemnity of Christ the King, may we all gaze upon the wood of the cross. It is the cross of Christ that makes saints and angels rejoice and offer praise and thanksgiving. It is the victorious cross of Christ that makes demons tremble in terror and flee before the infinite power of God's infinite love. Let us all believe and be saved. Let us all celebrate and offer praise. Hail the Holy Cross, which is our only